Indes Park, siamo vicini a 3 ore di gioco nella partita tra Boris Becker e Thomas Johansson. Becker si appresta a servire per il match sul punteggio di 5-4 nel quinto e decisivo set. Catena il pubblico, le due opposte tifoserie che ormai urlano ad ogni punto, e d'altronde la partita è arrivata al suo apice, al culmine. Al culmine anche il servizio di Becker, 19esimo ace e 15-0 per il tedesco.
15-0.
Ben 6 ace concentrati in questo set decisivo. Ne aveva messi a segno 13 in 4 set e ben 6 solo in questo set. Doppio fallo di Becker, e solo il quarto doppio fallo per il tedesco.
15-0.
Anche questo a sottolineare che Becker sta chiedendo moltissimo al suo servizio, quindi correndo dei rischi può commettere qualche errore, e d'altronde 4 doppi falli sono pochissimi in relazione a quanto Becker ottiene dalla battuta. Vedete, 20esimo ace. A 203 all'ora, quindi record di velocità proprio nel momento di chiudere il match. Anche questo è un aspetto del campione, che sa estrarre il massimo di se stesso nei momenti che contano. Fortunato Johansson, la palla colpisce il nastro e mette fuori tempo Becker, è protesa alla volée. 30 pari, non molle il ragazzino svedese, ragazzino oramai un giocatore vero, con poca esperienza ma con grandi qualità. Solo numero 114, però questa partita dimostra che vale molto di più. Becker a segno con la volée di dritto, match point. Con il servizio Becker riesce in 5 set in 3 ore di gioco a battere Thomas Johansson, dopo essere stato in svantaggio per 2 set, 4-6, 3-6, 6-2, 6-1, 6-4, il punteggio a favore del tedesco. È stata una lunga giornata di tennis quella di oggi, oltre alla vittoria di Becker ancora in 5 set dobbiamo ricordare la vittoria di Sampras in 4 set ai danni di Michael Joyce, che ha giocato piuttosto bene. Devo ricordare anche la vittoria di Renzo Furlan ai danni di Alberto Costa, soprattutto anche la sconfitta di Simmering, di Narciso con Jan Simmering, dopo che l'italiano era in vantaggio per 2-7-0. Per quanto riguarda il femminile, è uscita Kimiko Date per mano della connazionale Endo, ha vinto Rita Grande contro la tedesca Maier, ed è uscita soprattutto Mary Pierce, battuta dalla rappresentante del Kazakistan, Vitozeva. Bene, direi che per il momento è tutto, ci sarà qualche minuto di sosta per voi, ma subito dopo ancora tennis per il programma serale, Labat contro Martinez e Ivanisevic contro la Roca. Per il momento linea alla regia.
Bianco, brillante, dolce, leggero. No, non è zucchero. È vantaggio. Vantaggio. 4 volte meno calorie dello zucchero su dolci e bevande.
Derby Blue, Derby Blue. Tanta gente, tanti amici in più. Derby Blue.
E il bar piace di più.
Glu, 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 glu.
Dalla galassia della TV spazzatura c'è solo un modo per salvarsi dalla noia. Data astrale febbraio 1996. Tele più 2 ti porta alla scoperta della galassia dello sport. Viaggiando nel vecchio mondo del calcio, le emozioni più forti vengono sempre dal campionato italiano e da quelli di Germania e Inghilterra. Nell'orbita del pianeta dei giganti incontrerai una stagione di basket travolgente, mentre i fenomeni del volley combattono tra loro, perché nessuno dei mondi conosciuti può batterli. Seguendo la rotta delle magiche atmosfere del tennis, scoprirai le evoluzioni mozzafiato e le imprese leggendarie dei popoli dei ghiacci, prima di approdare nel territorio dei guerrieri, dove è sempre tempo di battaglie. Penetrando nell'atmosfera dell'atletica, sentirai la passione dei grandi meeting. Vedrai il pianeta dove ogni buca vale oro e toccherai un universo dove la paura non può esistere. Non conosce la noia chi esplora l'universo di Tele più 2.
It's another scorcher in Melbourne and the Swedish Iceman is facing meltdown. Can Stefan stand the heat in his last Aussie Open? She may not be as fit as in her prime, but Monica's still formidable. Don't ever rule out the fan sweetheart either. Gabby Sabby is still an ace. And this battle was fought 5 times last season. Juve and Parma in opposite corners again for the Italian Super Cup. Welcome to SportsCenter International Edition. I'm Roger Ware. Let's head straight for Melbourne. Sun hats at the ready for day 3 of the Australian Open tennis. This report from Lauren Clark.
The illustrious career of Stefan Edberg may be drawing to a close, but he's determined to go out in style. In his final visit to Flinders Park, he faces Jean-Philippe Fleurien in the second round. These days, Edberg struggles for every victory. No match is easy, and it's no different here. He loses the fourth set 6-2 and finds himself once again in a battle for survival. Fleurien puts the two-time champion under tremendous pressure in the second game of the fifth. But Edberg responds in vintage fashion. The crowd are firmly behind the popular Swede, but Fleurien's inspired. Edberg continues to charge into the net, but his volleys are less than convincing. Break point at 3-4, and his serve is treated with equal contempt. At 5-3, Fleurien's one point away from a famous victory. An accurate forehand cross, and Edberg bows out. The 10,000 capacity crowd unable to lift him, but he appreciates the support nevertheless.
I felt good in one way and bad in one way because I still lost the match, but at the same time you feel good about all the support that I had even throughout the match, and so it was mixed feelings.
Defending champion Andre Agassi is another Melbourne favourite. He was 2 points away from defeat in the first round, but finds Vince Spadia a much easier proposition. Spadia reached the third round last year, but never looks like causing an upset. Agassi takes the opening set 6-4. And a double break in the second gives him a two-set lead. Agassi loses concentration midway through the third. But a warning for verbal abuse seems to inspire him. He wins the next three games. It's 3-5 and Spadia is serving to stay in the match. An accurate backhand down the line, Agassi stays on course for his fourth Grand Slam title.
After putting out American qualifier Janet Lee in the first round of the Australian Open, Monica Seles seems in confident form against Katarina Studenikova of Slovakia in the second. Despite ongoing and intensive physiotherapy for a persistent groin injury, Seles has Studenikova exploring every angle of the court. And on some points, she makes it look almost too easy. With Australian Open victories in 1991, 92 and 93, Seles is keen to make this her first Grand Slam title since her professional comeback to tennis. She takes the first set by 6-1, showing the determination which made her name. Whatever Studenikova tries, Seles seems to have the perfect reply. The second set is a formality, the scoreline the same as the first. Seles goes through convincingly to a third round encounter with Julie Allard-Dessugui of France. Another player from Slovakia, this time Karina Habsudova, is also trying for a place in the third round. Age 22 and with a world ranking of 60, she faces Gabriela Sabatini of Argentina, ranked 6 here and ready to prove herself after a dismal first round defeat last year. Looking fit and confident, Sabatini wears down her opponent to take the first set 6-4. Her speed around the court and ability to play the winning shot never in doubt. It's match point, and Sabatini makes the most of it to clinch the match and her place in the next round. Coming up later in the show, more news and the latest results from Flinders Park.
Italian champions Juventus meet Parma for the Italian Super Cup. Both sides know each other well and bristle with star names. Names like Bulgaria's Hristo Stoichkov, who outstrips the Juve defence and posts an early warning. Italy's number one keeper, Peruzzi, is kept busy in the Juventus goal, but again, his handling is sure. And the importance of those early saves underlined after 33 minutes. Del Piero's cross is headed back across goal by Ravanelli. The defence gets in a tangle and Viali scores with ease, 1-0 Juventus. On 39, Stoichkov again races onto a through ball, confuses Peruzzi by appearing to handle, and it's the Juventus keeper who's in trouble as he's caught handing outside the box. The referee has no option other than to show Peruzzi red. But the replay shows he may have been hard done by, and Stoichkov gets away with it. Rampolla comes on as the 10 men of Juventus hold out to half-time. But can they protect their lead throughout the second half and gain revenge for last year's UEFA Cup final defeat? Well, at times in the second half, the swirling mist in Turin puts completing the game in doubt. And Parma defenders lose Viali in the gloom as his cross shot comes back off the post. Despite being a goal down, it's Juventus who come closest to adding a second. Mussi saves brilliantly to deny Ravanelli. But at the end of 90 minutes, it's Juventus who lift the Super Cup for the first time in their history. It's another proud chapter for Italy's most successful club side. And they do it the hard way after Peruzzi's controversial sending off.
Still ahead on SportsCentre International, later in the programme we'll hoist the mainsail for yachting in the exotic surroundings of Singapore. And right after the break we'll have more news from the Australian Open. We catch up with the progress of last year's runner-up. We'll be back with Arantxa Sánchez Vicario in a few moments.
Contro la violenza dei media.
What do you have to say to your fans?
Diretto da Oliver Stone, Assassini Nati, in esclusiva questo mese su Telepiù.
'95 was a consistent yet frustrating year for Arantxa Sánchez Vicario. She started as world number one, but lost in three consecutive Grand Slam finals. Now ranked third, the Spaniard looks good in the second round against Germany's Barbara Rittner. Sánchez takes the opening set 6-3 and builds a solid lead in the second. At 2-5, Rittner serves to stay in the match. An unforced error and Sánchez Vicario is safely through. There are also wins for Eva Maioli, Chanda Rubin and Naoko Sawamatsu, as the top players impose their authority on day three. The infamous Jeff Tarango stands in the way of Jim Courier and a place in the third round. Tarango pushes the former champion all the way, but still can't resist a pop at the umpire. It's a bruising encounter between two childhood friends with very different temperaments. Courier eventually winning in four sets, 7-5, 6-7, 6-4, 6-3. In other matches, there are comfortable victories for Thomas Muster and Michael Chang, but no such luck for Wayne Ferreira, who becomes the highest second-round casualty.
South Africa take an unassailable 4-1 lead in the seven-match one-day international series against England. Alan Donald does the damage, taking four early wickets, as the home side restrict England to 184 all out. The modest target appears more defendable as South Africa struggle to 9 for 2, but a captain's innings from Hansie Cronje sees them through to victory.
Still to come on SportsCentre International, our worldwide football roundup. And we'll tell you why the top scorer in the Copa Libertadores is swapping the sunshine of Brazil for the chill of Scotland. That's after the break.
Cinque squadre, un solo obiettivo. Il torneo delle cinque nazioni. Torneo delle Cinque Nazioni, dal 20 gennaio, in esclusiva, su Telepiù 2.
Brazilian star Jardel is swapping the heat of his native land for the chill surroundings of the Scottish League by joining Glasgow Rangers from Gremio. The 22-year-old striker makes his last appearance for the Copa Libertadores winners against European champions Ajax. Already, he knows where the future lays.
I just have to sign the contract with Glasgow Rangers of Scotland. As soon as we finish this game, I'm supposed to fly there to have medical examinations and be there on the 29th of December.
But what about the Gremio fans who raised $300,000 toward Jardel's transfer fee from Vasco da Gama? How does he feel about deserting those Gremio fans now?
Football's like that. You've got to enjoy it because a player's career is short. I'm a new player and I've got to make the most of it. Because my family is poor and I always try to help my family in need. That's the reason why I want to have a better life and a better wage.
Jardel is costing Rangers $4.5 million, and here's a taste of what the Scottish giants can expect for their money. A lanky 1.88 metres high, but a lean 75 kilos, Jardel always a threat in the air. And he leaves Gremio as top scorer in the Copa Libertadores. Rangers have dominated Scottish football for the last decade, and they're on course for an eighth consecutive league championship. The new boy will find the game played at a faster pace than he's been used to. But despite their domestic domination, the Ibrox club still fail to make any real impression on the European scene, and Jardel will be expected to instigate a change in fortunes. The temperature may be many degrees lower, but full houses at every home game generate the same red-hot passion as in Brazil. There's no doubting the warmth of Glasgow's welcome for the new signing, and if Jardel can deliver, his family will surely want no more.
Host team South Africa kicked off the African Nations Cup at the weekend against Cameroon before a packed stadium in Johannesburg. In green, Cameroon are not the force of old, and by half-time they were two down. Phil Masinga's early strike and some hesitant defending from this corner giving Mark Williams a simple goal. 10 minutes into the second half, South Africa capped a classy display with a brilliant goal created by Masinga and scored by Mosho. It's a dream start for the hosts. Sunday saw the first game in Group B. Neither Algeria in white nor Zambia could find a goal over the 90 minutes, though both teams went close and a point each was on balance a fair result. However, the much-anticipated clash in Group D between favourites Ghana and 92 champions Ivory Coast did not disappoint. Ghana underlined their status as favourites with two outstanding goals. A typically explosive volley from Tony Yeboah, a piece of individual brilliance from Abedi Pele, and Ivory Coast were well beaten. Back in Bloemfontein on day three, it was Sierra Leone and Burkina Faso. 15-year-old substitute Mohamed Kallon won it for Sierra Leone late in the second half. Two goals from the impressive El Kass were enough to carry Egypt to all 3 points against the Angolans, making their debut in the finals. Though Kinzinho for them did score a spectacular consolation in defeat. On day four, the other debutants, Liberia, led by World Footballer of the Year George Weah, surprised Gabon in Group C, holding out to win 2-1 after Gabon missed a host of chances. And completing the first phase of matches, Tunisia was shocked by Bukuane's brilliant early goal for Mozambique after just 5 minutes. Ben Rikisa's header from the free kick made the final score 1-1.
The former Italian Prime Minister, Silvio Berlusconi, is on trial charged with corruption in his business empire. The 59-year-old owns three national television networks and is president of AC Milan. He faces allegations of making bribes to tax police between 1989 and 1991. Under his presidency, AC Milan are Italian championships for three consecutive years, from 1992, and European Cup winners in 94. Still in Italy, the government freezes plans allowing clubs to field unlimited foreign players in domestic games as long as they are EU citizens. Now, this is typical of the confusion following the European Court ruling on UEFA's transfer and foreign player systems, the Bosman case. Latest move from UEFA, a statement indicating the three foreigners rule in their club competition stays. The European Commission say this is not acceptable and no one in Europe is above the law. What's this space? This one will run and run. Franz Beckenbauer is proposing a European club Super League featuring the likes of Ajax, AC Milan, Barcelona, Manchester United and his own Bayern Munich. A meeting between the clubs postponed, but they will meet UEFA in Geneva, Switzerland on February the 7th to discuss the various European club competitions, and it could be a long meeting. There's no place for either Eric Cantona or David Ginola in the latest French national squad. Coach Aimé Jacquet omits the big two, currently playing in England, from a 17-man squad to face Portugal in Paris next week, though there are five further friendlies before Euro 96, chances of the talented duo representing their country in England this summer must be slim. The bleak midwinter continues for English champions Blackburn Rovers. Woeful in Europe, the expensively assembled Ewood Park outfit now crash out of the FA Cup at the first hurdle. Ipswich Town relegated from the Premier last season, winning the third round replay in extra time. Last year's beaten finalists Manchester United survived their trip to Roker Park. Andy Cole's injury time winner sees off Sunderland and earns a fourth round tie at Reading. Meanwhile, Crystal Palace, semi-finalists last time round, are out, falling 4-3 at Port Vale. The stampeding Chicago Bulls have knocked just about everyone out of the way this season. Now they're up for a record-equalling 26 consecutive home wins. Find out if Philadelphia can stop them after the break.
Dal romanzo vincitore del premio Campiello, la più grande storia d'amore mai raccontata sullo schermo. Un mistero che dura da 2000 anni.
Ma chi è?
È Giuseppe il falegname.
Falegname,
Allora cosa vuoi?
Così impari a picchiare il mio pretendente.
Tu Maria la devi lasciare stare, capito?
Per te Maria non esiste.
Ma che vuoi, perché?
Ci sposiamo. Ci sposiamo! Noi ci sposiamo!
Per amore, solo per amore. In anteprima assoluta, questo mese su Telepiù 1.
Chicago Bulls still making the NBA headlines. Philadelphia 76ers trying to stop Michael Jordan and co, equaling a franchise record of 26 consecutive home wins. Bulls 13 ahead going into the second quarter, and a Jordan three-pointer. Now Dennis Rodman goes for glory. His first three-pointer since April 1994, and Chicago 22 to the good. Third quarter, and what a night for Rodman. One assist short of a first career triple-double. Not for long, though. Mind you, helps the Jordans on the team. No Jordan at the close. Backstrain the reason. Even so, final score. 76ers, 104, Bulls, 116. Boston Celtics have dropped their last seven on the road. Tough one then at the San Antonio Spurs, who've won 14 of their last 16 overall, and 9 of their last 10 at home. Spurs take control midway through the second quarter. Informed David Robinson to the fore. In all, Spurs convert 11 Boston turnovers. Vinny Del Negro on the end of this one. Robinson voted NBA Player of the Week, and here's why. Eric Montrass, the hapless Celt. Dana Barras' top scores were 22 points for Boston, but San Antonio always ahead. Fourth quarter, and Avery Johnson sent in by Elliott. It's the fifth consecutive double-double for Robinson. Final score, Celtics 97, Spurs 121. Elsewhere, 24 points for Clifford Robinson as the Trailblazers dumped the Nuggets for the second time in 4 days. And a fifth straight win for Indiana. Rick Smith's 29 points for the Pacers. Torrid time though for Toronto. The Raptors have now lost 7 of their last 8. And having lost 9 of their last 10 at Seattle, Cleveland travel more in hope and expectation. Good call, make that 10 out of 11.
The junks in Singapore Harbour are joined by boats of a different variety for the start of the final race of the Singapore Straits Regatta, a four-day event featuring 5 races in all. Conditions are difficult for the yachtsmen, who have been expecting the northeast monsoon winds, which are common at this time of year. Instead, they are battling to find speed in the mild wind conditions. Jenny 3, skippered by local man Jeffrey Lowe, and High Flyer with Neil Pride of Hong Kong in charge, start strongly. Millennium, skippered by Australian Ray Roberts, is also very much in contention. Roberts, winner of the 1995 King's Cup in Thailand, is keen to launch a challenge for the America's Cup in the year 2000. And he shows his form by taking a clear lead. The spinnakers are raised as the yachts push to find some power for the finish. The crew of Millennium struggle to control theirs and to hold on to their lead. Jenny 3 is close behind, a great achievement as she is sailing with a damaged keel sustained by hitting rocks shortly before the start of the second race. High Flyer is in third place. But no one can catch Ray Roberts and Millennium, who emerge as deserving victors. And they are clearly delighted with their win. More yachting news. In the Star Class World Championships, The winners of the third race are Jose Luis Dureste and Javier Hermida of Spain. Hans Wallen and Bobby Losey take second, Colin Bischel and David Giles third. Torben Grail and Marcelo Ferreira of Brazil maintain overall first place, with the two Swedish crews in second and third.
Wayne may be thirsty for success, but he's facing a drought at Los Angeles, who are winless in four. Can they overcome Calgary? Stay tuned for the NHL.